Now we'll discuss transportation problem. So this is an example of a transportation problem. As you can see in the board, I have already written the a problem. So what is a transportation problem? Actually, let me explain a transportation problem. In a manufacturing industry, where the things are produced are not sold from the same place. So there is a manufacturing plant where the things are being produced, and there is some warehouse. Warehouse are generally with the manufacturing plant, and the things are sold from the outlets. The things are sold like think about Bata shoe company. So Bata shoes are produced at Patanagar. There is a plant there where all the shoes are being produced, but throughout India or throughout Calcutta there are several stores of Bata where the shoes are being taken and sold from there. So it is for a company, it is important to transport the finished goods from its origins to destination.
Sir, your voice is breaking.
My voice is breaking. So can everybody hear properly?
Yes, sir, I can hear.
Yes, sir, I can hear.
Okay. So in that case, I think in that case...
Sir, your voice is breaking.
Maybe it's a difficulty in your audio or something like that. I think everybody can, if others can hear me, so I think I'm okay with it. So you have to transport the finished goods from origins to destination. Actually, origins I have written as O1, O2 and O3. You can see O1.
Sir, maybe my network is little down.
Okay, yes. But just try to listen to me what I'm saying. So
O1,
O2 and O3 are my origins or warehouses where the things are kept, and D1, D2, D3, D4 are the destinations or the outlets from where the things are sold. Okay, and this is the cost matrix. This is the matrix. I think all of you know what is a matrix is. Matrix is arrangement of numbers. So this is a cost matrix, means I have written the values as the different transportation costs from different origins to different destinations. So what I mean by this 24, so if I am transporting one unit from origin 1 to destination 2, my per unit cost is 24 rupees or 24 paisa. All of them are in the same denomination. Get it? So O1 to D2 is 24 per unit transportation cost. Say this is 21, O2 to D4. O2 to D4 is 21. Means if I am transporting one unit from origin 2 to destination 4, my cost is 21 rupees. So that's how I write. Okay, so and all these values are given as the different transportation costs per unit. Mind that per unit transportation costs from different origins to different destinations. And you can see I have written, and these are the costs, this whole cost matrix. These are three rows and four columns. So I have four outlets and three origins. And you can see in the board that there I have written availability, and there is small, I could not write it properly. There is something called demand. So demand for the columns or destinations and availability for the rows or origins. Means, as I have said, I was just explaining about the transportation problem. So this is my cost matrix. So from different origins to different destinations, the costs are given. And sometimes it is possible that somewhere maybe it is the value is no value is given or is. See, you can. I'm writing a dash instead of 19. I'm writing a dash. Can you see? O2D2.
Yes, sir.
So I'm
yes,
a dash. So it's possible that no value is given for a particular particular case, particular cell. So that means from O2 to D2, no transportation is possible. No transportation is possible. Okay, if no value is given or dash something, nothing is written or dash is given. Mind that not zero, but some dash like that. So that means from that particular origin to that particular destination, nothing can be transported. Okay, so I'm going back to my 19, whatever was there. And then I was talking about availability and demand. So origins have availability, means as I've said, origins are the storehouse or warehouses where the things are kept. So the maximum number of things that are stored are called availability. So in O1, there are 100 units available, means from origin 1, you can distribute, you can transport 100 units. From origin 2, you can transport 80 units. And origin 3, you can transport 90 units. So that's what the meaning of availability. So from origins have availability and the destination has demand. Destinations has demand. So what is the demand? I cannot write this. The small thing that I have written is demand. See here, this small thing is demand, okay? So I have only written D because there is not much space I had, so I could not write. So destinations has demand, means how many units are demanded for that destination. So by some prior knowledge, companies can decide, okay, this destinations require this amount of particular pair of shoes. So D1 has 60 units as demand, D2 has 70 units as demand, D3 has 75 and D4 has 65 units. So these are the demands of different destinations. Okay, now the job is how many units are to be transported from different origins to different destinations so that the demand is fulfilled, the availabilities are exhausted, and total transportation cost is minimum. I repeat, now the problem is, so you have origins and destinations. Origins have availabilities, destinations has demands, and you have the per unit transportation costs prescribed in the cost matrix for different origins, from different origins to different destinations. And now the problem is you have to transport from different origins to different destinations in such a way so that the demand are fulfilled and the availabilities are exhausted, and also the total transportation cost is minimum. So total transportation cost is minimum. So that is the question, that is the problem. Now if you have anything to ask, have you followed the question, have you followed the problem? Please tell me you have followed the question. Is it clear? Is the question clear?
Yes, sir.
If anything,
yes, sir.
So,
yes, sir.
Anything to ask, please ask me. So I'm writing it again in a bigger manner. I'm writing. Somebody please tell me the values that I have written. So this is O1, O2 and O3. Then D1,
yes, sir.
D3, D4. Somebody please tell me the row wise values.
20, 24.
20,
18,
then 16,
19,
25, 25, 25, 25, 25, 21, 21, then 20, 18, 18, 19, 19, 20, 23, 23. And the availabilities are
100, 80
and
90. 80, 90.
90.
And the demands were 60.
60, 70, 75, 65.
So that is my question. That is the problem that we were discussing. So is it okay now? Do you understand? So all these are called costs. Find that. So this is CIJ. I denote that as by CIJ. So CIJ, if you want to write, CIJ is the cost per unit transportation cost from ith origin to jth destination. CIJ is the cost of transportation, per unit transportation cost from ith origin to jth destination. So that means, how can I write 18 as? So 18 is my, you can tell me, 18 is, in terms of CIJ, how can I write 18 is? Somebody please. C14, because it is first row and fourth column. So C14 is 18. This 18, got it?
Yes, sir.
Then 16, this 16 is C21 is 16, like that. So everywhere, okay, so that is how I write CIJ is my cost, per unit transportation cost. And we will write XIJ, well, I write, so say I'm writing XIJ is the number of units to be transported from ith origin to jth destination. So XIJ is my decision variable. XIJ is the number of units transported from ith origin to jth destination. That is my XIJ. So this is my decision variable. That is the decision that I need to find, that I need to make. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, so this is called a transportation problem. So I have to distribute in such a way so that the total cost is minimum. So that the total transportation cost is minimum. Okay? So, like, as I've said, I'm giving example, this is 5 bits, XIJ, X12 is 5. That means I'm transporting from first origin 1 and putting it to destination 2. That's why it is X12 is equals to 5. So, transportation problem is especially, it's a kind of linear programming problem. We have already studied linear programming problem. Transportation problem is a special kind of linear programming problem. And we have solved the problem, similar kind of problems, but we have only taken 2 rows and 3 columns in an example 2, where we have solved them graphically. But here, this problem cannot be solved graphically. We will see how we can solve it, but not today, maybe in the next class. But actually, let's, as I am saying, this is a linear programming problem, so how we can convert this transportation problem a linear programming problem. So let's find that. Let's do that. So here our distance variable is XIJ. So XIJ, distance variable is XIJ. I is from, say, if I am having n rows, if I have my cost matrix, sorry, something is wrong, no? So let's generalize. So we have a cost matrix of, say, of m rows and n columns, m cross n, cross matrix of m cross n. In that case, I will vary from 1, 2 up to m, and j will vary from 1, 2 up to n. Say, well, I'm trying to generalize that a cost matrix, if I am having m rows means m origins and n columns means n destinations, if I am having that, and xij is the amount of transported from ith origin to jth destination. In that case, I will vary from 1 to m, j will vary from 1 to n. And because in Cij, what is Cij? As I've said, Cij is the per unit transportation cost. So I, in this case also, I will also vary from 1 to m, and j will also vary from 1 to n. So Cij is the per unit transportation cost, and you are transporting xij units. So total transportation cost becomes, Cij into xij, Cij into xij, and you have to take the double summation. So double summation means for over I and for over j. That's a generalized expression that I am giving, and that is my total cost, and our objective is to minimize this total cost, total cost minimization. See, plus, if you are not following, do not worry, we will give the example. This is generalization that I am doing, so keep it in hand. After that, when I'll give example, it will be a little more clearer. Okay, so just write now for the time being. Then we have constraints. What are the constraints? That the you cannot, for each origin, you cannot transport more than what you have, isn't it? If your availability is 100 units, you can only transport maximum of 100 units. So in that case, my first constraint is summation xij. When I am summing over j, I will get is less than equals to bi. And this is for I equals to, this is for I equals to 1 to m. This is for the rows. So for each row, I'll give the example. When I'll write elaborately, you'll understand. So for each row, so x11, like if I write x11 plus x12 plus x13, see, this I is fixed. First suffix is fixed, 1, 1. So I'm just changing the value of the column. Here the second suffix is changing, 1, 2, 3. So that means the value of the column changing, and that's why I'm summing over j. J is my column. J represents column. So if I add this, I will, what I'll get? I'll get the first value of the first row, total availability in the first row. So that is nothing but my b1. That's what I've written. And the second constraint is, and the second constraint is for column, the demand. Whatever the demand is for each column, the total demand, total supply, total transportation value cannot exceed the demand. Because if your requirement is 100 units, how, what you will do with 105 units? 5 units will not be sold then. So maximum, either you fulfill the demand or you may not be able to fulfill the demand. So in that case, for column, what we will do, we will sum, that is xij. Now it will be sum over I, and we will get that as aj. That's just a notation. So the aj is the demand for the jth column. Bi is the availability of the ith column. Aj is the demand of the jth column. AJ is the demand of the jth column, BI is the availability of the ith row, and here J varies from 1 to n. And obviously the third last part is xij greater than equals to 0. Xij is greater than equals to 0 means either you transport some amount or you transport no amount. So it cannot have a negative value. You cannot transport minus 5 units from one origin to another destination. So it has to be non-negative. So this is how the transportation problem can be converted to a linear programming problem. So this is the objective function. As the total cost is minimum, then these are the constraints. We have m plus n constraints in this case, total m plus n constraints for rows as well as columns. And third part is the non-negativity restriction. So third part is the non-negativity restriction, and it is a linear programming problem because highest power of the variable is 1. Highest power of the maximum power of the variable is 1. Here also, here in the objective function also, in the constraints also. So this is a linear special kind of, actually it's a linear programming problem, and we will solve the linear programming problem, but since there are more than two variables, so we cannot solve this problem using the graphical solution or in, but we will use something different, some other method to solve the transportation problem. So as you have said, m and n parts, I said the cost matrix is of m rows or n columns, m cross n. In this case, this cost matrix has 3 rows and 4 columns. So in this case, it is 3 cross 4. The value of m is 3 and value of n is 4. Do you get my point? The value of m is 3 and value of n is 4 in this case. So that's what I mean by m cross n, the cost matrix. It can be any number of rows and any number of columns. If you think realistically, for a particular manufacturing company, they have several places throughout the India where the warehouses are there, and several places have the outlets. So they have to transport the items from the warehouses to the outlets, the destinations. So just for an example, we have taken 3 rows and 4 columns. It could be 20 rows and 50 columns. No problem with that. Same thing can be done. Same process can be extended. But for that particular problem, you have to use a computer program to solve. Here we are taking 3-4 rows so that it can be solved using by hand. It can be solved by hand. You can do it.
Sir, are you presenting the code?
To solve the transportation problem, there are several steps. Actually, we will be solving the transportation problem in 3 steps, 3 major steps. So please write down the step 1. We will discuss the step 1 and then we will do the step 2 and step 3 in the next. So step 1 is, please write, check whether the problem is balanced or not. So we are discussing the algorithm. Step 1 is check whether the problem is balanced or not. A problem will be balanced, don't write this, the problem will be balanced if total availability is equal to total demand. Total availability is equal to total demand. So total, what is the total availability over here? It's 270.
270.
And the total demand is also 270. Just add the demand values and add the availability values. So total availability is total demand. Here it is 270 for both the cases. So that means this problem is balanced. So if the problem is balanced, then we can go to step 2. If the problem is not balanced, we cannot go to step 2. We have to make the problem as balanced. We have to balance it first. Okay? Can you follow? So how to balance? Let's take an example. Now my question is, how the problem can not be balanced? I said the problem is balanced if both total availability is total demand. So how the problem may not be balanced.
When total availability does not equals total demand.
Means what? Means what?
Demand is not fulfilled. Good. More demand.
Yes. Either demand is more or availability is more.
Yes. Yes.
So like say this is
not a optimum level.
No, not optimum. Nothing is optimum yet. We haven't done. We will do optimum part later. Optimum is here in this case. Optimum is the maximum or minimum. In this case, we are trying to minimize. When we do the minimization, then it becomes minimum. There are several possibilities. I have missed one thing to say. This is a deterministic problem because everything is given. Every values, every here only thing we need to find out what are the different allotment is possible. There are several ways I can distribute this 100, 80 and 90 was there. I have just changed it to 80. There are several ways that distribution possible. Possibly there are several distributions of allotments. Allocations are possible from different origins. But we have to choose that allotment which gives me the total transportation cost as minimum. Which gives me the total transportation cost as minimum. So that is the optimum. But several possibilities are there. So it's a deterministic because every information is provided. Our job is to choose the best. Our job is to choose the best. Okay. So I was discussing if the problem is not balanced. So either demand is more or availability is more. So I am assuming the demand is more. So I am making the availability as in 90. I am making it 80. Okay. Can you see? So in this case, the total availability becomes 260, and the total demand is 270. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So that means if your availability is less than the demand, will you be able to supply, fulfill the demand?
No, sir.
You have.
No, sir.
Okay. You have 100 rupees with you. Can you buy a thing 105 rupees? You cannot. So,
No, sir.
If you have 260 units available, so there will always be 10 units which will not be, 10 demands could not be fulfilled. Okay, so listen carefully. If availability is less, if total availability is less, then we introduce an extra origin with transportation cost as 0 units. Can you see what I am writing? I have made another row at the bottom. With transportation per unit, transportation cost as 0 units. And the value, available value is 10 units. And that will balance my problem. Do you get my point? Because total demand was 270 and total availability was 260. So I needed 10 units more. So what I'll do? I have made a fictitious origin. I have made a fictitious origin O4. Fictitious means unreal. I made an unreal origin O4 where the transportation costs I have kept as 0 units and the value, available value is the balance. So that it becomes equal both sides. Total availability becomes total demand. Total availability.
Sir?
Get my point. Yes.
Sir, if I need more than 10 units, then?
No, in that case, here it is 10 units. Here it is 10 units. That will be balance, isn't it?
Okay.
If it is 50 units,
okay.
You put 50 over there?
Yes.
If it is 50 units to balance, then you put 50 units over there. Got it?
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, this
means it's like a miscellaneous account in balance sheet.
I don't know much about account.
It could be.
I don't know much about account, so I can't comment on that. And if the other way around, like instead of less availability if you have less demand. If demand is less, like I have made this 65 as 60. Can you see? Fourth one.
Yes, sir.
D4 I have made 60.
Yes,
so in
sir.
That case, the total yes, becomes. In that case, the total becomes 265. The total demand is 265, and you have the availability 270. You have the availability is 270. So that means there will be always 5 units which will be always somewhere kept in the warehouse. 5 units will be always left in the warehouse. That 5 units, because demand is less than the what is being produced. So there will be 5 units which is less. So if the demand is less, then we will introduce one extra destination, fictitious destination, D5, with transportation cost as 0 units. And the demand is that balance value, 5, that balance value. So that the total availability and total demand becomes balanced. Do you get my point? If the demand is less, we will introduce a fictitious destination with per unit transportation cost as 0 units, and the demand will be the difference between the availability and the demand. Same way that we have done in case of availability. So it is important to understand what to introduce. If availability is more, then we will introduce a fictitious destination. If demand is more, then we will introduce a fictitious origin. And that's how we balance the problem and go to step 2. Is it okay? Have you understood? Have you followed?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So next is step 2. I'll just inform the what is step 2. Step 2 is to find the initial basic feasible solution. Basic feasible solution, IBFS. Initial basic feasible solution. And there are 3 methods of finding IBFS. The 3 methods names are Northwest Corner Rule. Northwest Corner Rule. Number 2 is Matrix Minima Method. Matrix Minima Method. And number 3 is Vogel's Approximation Method, VAM. Northwest Corner Rule, Matrix Minima Method, Vogel's Approximation Method. There are 3 methods. All 3 methods tells you from where to where. When you are distributing, there are 3 questions to be answered. There are 3 questions to be answered. Number 1, first question is from where. So from where you are distributing. From where. So that is the first question. Second question is to where. So, from which origin you are transporting? That is the first question. Second question, to which destination you are transporting? So, that's the second question. And the third question is how many units? How many units you are transporting? So, these 3 questions are to be answered. And Xij is the answer. X is the answer of how many. I is the answer of from where, J is the answer of to where, X, I, J. X is the answer of how many units you are transporting, that is X. I is the answer from where you are transporting, and J is the answer to where you are transporting. So if I am writing X, 1, 2 is 40, that means I am transporting from first origin to second destination, and how many units I am transporting? I am transporting 40 units. So that is the answer. That is how we will find out. So all those three methods tells you from where to where. All those three methods name I have written: northwest corner, matrix minima, and BAM. All these three methods tells you from where and to where. And for the how many, the answer is, it is always minimum of availability and demand. We will discuss it from the next class.